Joe Fitzsimons speaks the inoxidants in materials. Materials. And he's going to talk about some joint work with Robert Sheffy from Edinburgh and Anne Broadbent from Water Group.
Thanks very much. So, what I want to talk about today is, I guess, in line with the graph state between the measurement place QC team that's been running through the mornings. But I want to talk about something maybe a bit different than other people that we've been talking about, and in particular how we can use measurement place computation to do something a little bit different in a cryptographic setting, and also in the context of complexity. So I'm going to talk a bit about the implications for interactive groups. So as Bob said, this is joint work with Alan and Emra and Anna Moyle. So basically I'm going to go through three parts of the talk. I'll tell you a little bit about our blind quantum computing protocol. Then I'll tell you a bit about interactive groups. And then we'll go on to the last section where I'll talk a bit about how we can use the blind quantum computing protocol to get rid of quantum verifiers in certain quantum interactive proof systems. So to begin with, we're going to go into the blind quantum computation. I guess I should probably tell you what it is. So the basic idea is that we have two people, Alice over here and Bob. And Alice has very limited power in terms of what computation she can perform, whereas Bob has some much more complex device. So we're going to assume Alice has very limited power but wants to be able to use a quantum computer for whatever reason. Now, this may be for solving some problem that's in BQP, or it could be for processing quantum information. Perhaps she wants to get some input state from someone else and produce some output state. Bob has a quantum computer and is willing to help Alice solve her problem for whatever reason. Maybe he's being paid. But Alice doesn't trust Bob, and Bob won't give Alice the device. So is there some way we can come up with some protocol that allows this to be done in a secure fashion without Alice having to reveal anything? So in particular, we don't want Alice's input to be revealed. We don't want the output of Alice's intended computation to be revealed. And we don't want the computation to be revealed. So maybe Alice's input to the computation is someone else's public key, and the output is their private key, and the intended computation is some kind of factoring. So the basic idea is Alice doesn't want Bob to know any of this. So maybe Alice works in GCHQ and Bob doesn't. And so Alice just doesn't trust him at all. So everything in Alice's computation must be encrypted in some way. So the information must be hidden from Bob. Now, there's been some work on this before us. And so there have been schemes which limited Alice's power to a quantum memory plus Foley operations. And I guess you can imagine how that might work, because your Foley operations are enough to hide anything with a quantum one-time pad. And so you can imagine encrypting and decrypting using this, and you can just... but the scheme proposed for this, while it can do any polynomial-sized quantum circuit, and the privacy is perfect, so what's being computed is completely hidden. If Bob cheats, this is undetected. So if Bob interferes with your calculation, you don't know he's done it. And this may not seem very important. If you're factoring a number, for example, you can easily check. So if you've any problem in NP, it's not really an issue. It becomes an issue, however, when the problem is not in NP. So, we don't know that PQP is contained within NP. It seems very unlikely that it is. So, if we have a task like simulating some quantum system or some other PQP complete problem, it's very hard for Alice to verify that the solution she gets is correct. There's been other work which has been able to detect detect interference from POP with polynomial security. But this is for a limited set of functions. And in this case, the function is public. So our contribution is basically to assume Alice can prepare single qubit states. These are just basically qubits prepared at some discrete angles in the equatorial plane of the block sphere. Turns out the technology to do this isn't much at all. So this side of things, the glasses you get going into 3D films in the cinema are more or less sufficient to polarize photons. And so you can do something like this. But so the privacy is perfect, and we can do any polynomial size quantum circuit. And if Bob cheats, he's detected with exceptional exponentially small probability. Which means we can pretty much guarantee that there's been no interference. And this is this is important when we come to talk about quasi-interactive groups. The way our scheme works is basically to take the idea of measurement-based computation. Because in this setup you have some kind of classical control computer and some quantum resource state. And so it seems quite natural to associate Alice with the control computer and Bob with the quantum operations. So we're going to have Alice send some quantum information to Bob, which he uses to prepare the initial state, and then she's going to drive the measurements that Bob makes by choosing the angles in a graph set. So to give you an idea of how we can use quantum systems to hide gates, we'll take this example. So this is just the two qubit teleportation protocol. So we have some input state phi. We perform a control Z operation between the qubit storing our data and some ancillary qubit, which will assume to be in the plus state, so just 0 and plus 1. And then we measure it somewhere in the xy plane. So this angle alpha here is just the angle from the x axis. So it's rotated somewhere in the xy plane. And then we apply some correction operator dependent on our measurement outcome. So it turns out that the operator needed is just an x gate. And then the result is this j alpha, which is essentially a z rotation followed by a Hadamard gate. So we can just track what happens through the computation, or through this little protocol. We start off with our state phi tensor to it plus. We apply the control Z, so there's a conditional phase applied. So the plus becomes a minus only for the one component of phi. Okay, I'm going to attempt to read this out. But basically, when you apply the rotation here, you get this resulting state, which is fairly easy to verify. And you have either 0 or 1 component to it. And then we're applying some correction operator dependent on this. And so we get out A plus e to the I alpha B minus. So the 0 has gone to plus and the minus, the 1 has gone to minus, which means there's a Hadamard gate in here, but it's also picked up this phase that's dependent on whether it's 0 or 1. So that's what this z alpha is. It's just a rotation by an angle alpha about the z axis.
So is this a state transfer?
It's just two qubit teleportation. So you're just moving it, but you're adding a gate while it moves. So one way to view cluster state computation is as a big series of these operations. You've got control sets that are just to go up the graph state, and then you have some measurement in the xy plane with a correction operator applied afterwards. So this is just an equivalent. stabilizer formulas or any other way you want to look at it. But this is just mainly intuitive for what we're going to do. So the basic idea to hide gates comes from this two-qubit teleportation protocol. So the idea here is that if we know this measurement in the xy plane, the angle is first of all telling us what J alpha gate is being applied, what the angle is. So if we split the rotation, sorry, this plus should still be phi instead. But if we add a z rotation initially at Alice's side, and so we compare some single qubit states like this, you have the z rotation applied to the plus state, and then you only have to tell Bob the angle alpha plus theta instead of alpha. Now, because theta can be chosen uniformly at random, this means Bob is told the sum of alpha plus theta, but because he doesn't know theta, this is also uniformly distributed. So he gains no information about alpha from the angle he's told. So that sounds like it, by this case, but there's one more problem, which is that Bob is still getting the correct measurement result here. So he is learning something about the state. And ideally, we wouldn't want him to know what the correct projection of the state was onto any basis. So in order to do this, we add in an additional angle. Okay, so this is what I was just saying. We add in an additional multiple of pi. So we have this theta applied to the plus state initially. So we only need to tell about alpha plus theta. And then if we now add this random multiple of pi, so either 0 or 1 pi, this effectively flips its measurement basis. And since you're randomly flipping the measurement basis, you're randomly flipping the output bit. So you've just one time padded this measurement result. That we need to be not revealing anything about the location of various gates. And in order to do, say, a single qubit gate versus an entangling gate in the cluster state model, we need to do some measurements either in the equatorial plane, in this XY plane, or some measurements that are along the Z axis. And so what we've had before here, this is essentially hiding an XY plane measurement, but we've no way to hide Z basis measurements. So we don't. This is another kind of graph state. It's just arranged in a slightly different way so that it's universal with XY measurements. It's fairly easy to see this. You've got these blocks that are repeated, so the whole state is just gotten by targeting these. And each one of these can be used to implement a unitary on two qubits. So there's a number of unitaries that you need to be able to perform. You can use single qubit unitaries. By choosing the angles in this way, we have alpha, beta, gamma, which shows basically a z rotation, an x rotation, then a z rotation, and then these two entangling gates cancel out. So we get some operator SU2 on the first qubit and some on the second qubit. But in particular, we may want to do a Hadamard gate. So this is pi over 2, pi over 2, pi over 2. Zero everywhere else. We may want to do this pi over 8 gate t. So this is just a rotation by the angle pi over 4 on the first qubit, and then everything else is rendered in zeros. And we might want to do the identity. So we have zeros everywhere. The other thing, sorry.
Are these measurements still done in the x basis?
So this is just the angle in the xy plane.
Okay.
So it's either, so 0 means the x basis, and pi over 2 means y basis.
Okay.
And so there's this pi over 4 is in between.
Okay.
So this is kind of x plus y. So we also need to be able to do an entanglement gate between neighboring qubits. And this can be done fairly simply. So we just choose a pi over 2 gate up at the top, and then either side at the bottom we have pi over 2 and minus pi over 2. So it's reasonably straightforward to verify that this works. These two up at the top are introducing these J alphas with alpha equal to 0, so they're two Hadamard gates, which obviously cancel out. We have up here a Z rotation, followed by another two Hadamard gates, which will cancel themselves out as well. And then this is a Hadamard gate, then a Z rotation, Hadamard gate coming in from here, as well as a CZ from this, lying in the cluster state. Then another Hadamard gate, a Z rotation, Hadamard gate, and then the last control Z coming in from the end of this. So you get some decomposition like this, which is just equal to the C naught gate. So basically this is a universal set. So we have Hadamard, pi over 8 gate, and we have a C naught gate. And I guess the thing to notice here is that we only have to use multiples of pi over 4. So we can make a discrete choice of our angles so that we're at no point in the blind computation protocol are we going to have to communicate real numbers or anything like this. So we're only going to have to be able to communicate some integer multiple of pi over 4. So the other thing I haven't talked about is measurements. So I guess it's fairly straightforward to think at the end of the computation how you make measurements. You just measure the state. So we can measure more on the x-axis, that's fine. that's fine, but we may want to make measurements during the computation. And this is very important for being able to do fault tolerance. You need to be able to continuously make measurements on the system or reset qubits, even if you're not measuring them. So one way to build this into the framework we have is to say we're going to use these unitaries to tile up a certain section, and then we're going to make regular measurements in fixed locations. So this is just every second wire. And then we have room for four of these blocks, and then we have more measurements, and we just repeat this. So this obviously isn't revealing anything about the underlying computation, because we haven't decided what we want to do yet. So these little red measurement operators are just basically measuring the qubit and then adding in a new qubit in the plus state. So I guess you can see this as this graph state will do the right thing. So x here is just measuring in the x basis, and this is just a new input qubit. And the four x's just cancel each other out. So you can write this instead as one of these bricks within the brick group state with a single z measurement. Now, I said before that we shouldn't do z measurements because they leak something about the gate structure of the underlying computation. But now we're making z measurements in a regular pattern that doesn't depend in any way on the computation. But this allows us to measure qubits. So we have some wires that are just used for measurements and other ones that are used as data qubits within the computation. So we only use these measurement wires to make measurements. We don't store information on them. And I guess it's important to point out now that because we have this tile of four U's, we're able to do a C0 across the measurement wire before it's measured. So this means we still have a universal gate set between the data qubits, and if we want, we can just do instead a C0 onto a measurement wire in order to measure the neighboring qubit. Okay, so how does our protocol work? Well, the basic idea is that we get Alice to prepare these equatorial plane states. So we have some state plus that's rotated through some angle theta, and we're going to choose theta to be some multiple of pi over 4. So Alice sends each of these to Bob, and Bob produces a regular array from them, and entangles them to make a brickwork state. So each of these is indexed xy, that gives its location in the brickwork state. And so Alice knows the value of theta xy for each one, which are chosen uniformly at random, but Bob doesn't. The idea here is basically that because Bob doesn't know the multiple of pi over 4 that's in this angle theta, it means he's equally likely to get a plus state as a minus state. So this is a maximally mixed state. So each column, we're going to have to tell Bob which angle to measure. So Alice just computes an angle delta xy, which is basically taking the measurement angle she would use in the brickwork state with no corrections applied at all, theta xy, and then we need to apply corrections depending on the previous results that we know have been applied, although Bob doesn't know what's happened. So these are going to be, I've labeled these SX and SZ. So if we have a Z byproduct on this state, we need to add pi. And if we have no Z byproduct, we don't add pi. If we have an X byproduct, we need to flip the sign of theta. So that's just what this is doing. Now, we've already prepared these instead of in the plus state, in the state e to the I xy. So we need to undo this, and that's where this minus the theta term is coming in. And this plus or xy pi It's just the random bit I talked about earlier, so that Bob doesn't know the measurement result. So this is just, this last bit is just acting as a one-time pad on the measurement result. So if Bob doesn't know Rx, then he doesn't know what his measurement result means. Okay, so Bob then takes this should be delta xy up here. So measuring that angle is equivalent to applying a rotation phi xy plus this random number times pi on the original brickwork state, on a perfect brickwork state with no underlying rotations. He then sends back his measurement results mxy to Alice so she can compute the new byproduct operators for the next qubit in this section and so on. And we just repeat in this way. So this starts the computation on. They go through one qubit at a time, working down each column, and go across the whole length of the computation. And obviously at the end, Alice has her outputs from the measurement results. And so if she's done a classical computation, then she has classical outputs, which she can read her answer from. If she's a quantum computation, they just don't measure the last row. The last column. So the last column is just the output. Equally, if we have another set of qubits as the input, they can be entangled in the first column. So they don't have to be in this state for the first column because they're just providing the input to the computation. Now, I mentioned that we don't want Bob to know anything about Alice's computation. So if we need to put in some qubits, these can be one-time padded at the beginning, just a quantum one-time pad. So we're just applying either an x, y, z Pauli operator or the identity with equal probability. And this guarantees that you have a completely mixed state. But in general, if we're doing a classical input, classical output computation, or a classical input, quantum output computation, then we can assume that these start off in the equatorial plane, and we're going to treat the input as just being in the zero state. And then the first region of the computation is simply to write the input state onto that. Okay, so to prove that it's blind, we need to show a couple of things. The first is that the distribution of the classical information that Bob obtains is independent of the input. And the second is that if given a particular distribution of classical information, that the quantum state is fixed. So the idea here is that Bob shouldn't be able to learn, either by measuring the quantum state or looking at the input he gets, anything about the underlying computation. Now, we say the protocol B is blind while leaking at most LX, because actually our protocol does leak something. And it turns out it's impossible not to. You're always leaking an upper bound on the size of the computation. I guess this is very easy to see because Bob has some finite-sized quantum computer and you're using a certain amount of resources in it, and you cannot possibly have squeezed an arbitrarily large computation into this finite amount of resource. Now, it's only an upper bound. You can pad it as much as you want, but you are still learning an upper bound in the dimensions of the circuit, both the width and the depth. So, basically, the proof is very simple, because theta xy is chosen uniformly at random. This angle, delta xy, is also uniformly distributed. And so the distribution of this classical information is completely independent of any choice of the underlying measurement angles, theta xy. Also, we can see it as being independent of or xy. So, now if we have 4x equal to 0, we get some quantum state, where we have 0 plus e to the I delta x minus. So, basically the idea is that these differ by pi, and they're in the equatorial plane, which means they're on top. And if we have a mixture, so we can have this state or this state with equal probability, so actually the angles here don't matter, because we have a matching state. If we're just adding together the density matrix space for this pure state and this pure state, then we just get the identity divided by two. And obviously that doesn't depend at all on anything, not on any of these input properties. Okay. That takes care of the blindness issue. So we have a way of doing computation for any quantum circuit now, where Bob can't learn anything about the computation that's going on. But maybe Bob's a bit devious and decides to lie about the measurement outcomes, or he decides to just measure in a different angle, or do something entirely different. Substitute some of his own qubits for input qubits he was given, or something like this. Now, we need a way to detect this. So, the basic idea here is to use authentication codes. And basically, these have been introduced before. And the idea is that Alice can send a message to Bob by encoding it in some essentially randomly chosen quantum error correction code that lengthens the message, sending it to Bob. And as long as Alice and Bob know the error correction code that's being chosen, Bob can check whether it's still in the code space for it. So if Bob has a if Bob receives a message and it's not in the space the space he expects it to be in the vector space, then he knows there's been some interference along the way. He doesn't need to know the value of the message beforehand. He doesn't need to know the quantum state. But if we embed a two-level system in a system with four levels, well then, if we're not within this two-dimensional subspace, something has gone wrong along the way. So our idea is basically to take this, and instead of Alice sending a message to Bob, and them having to share some K, and worry about some eavesdropper, Alice is going to send a message back to herself, basically. And the message is going to, so she doesn't have to share a key with anyone because she encodes it originally with a key, sends it off, and then receives it back sometime later. And there's a number of reasons why this is needed. One of these is so Alice doesn't need a quantum memory. As long as the state that would be her register is encoded with an authentication code, she doesn't need to worry about it. She can give it to Bob instead. She doesn't need to take care of it. She'll know if he interferes with it, and if he doesn't, she'll know that too. So it's more or less as good as having it herself. The other thing we need to be able to do, though, which is why we don't use exactly these authentication codes, is that we want Bob to be able to perform some unitary on the encoded state in a blind way. So we just use a very simple version of an authentication code, which is basically to take a qubit. So each of our qubits we encode with some authentication code. Sorry, with some quantum error correction code. And that's fixed. So we have some fixed choice of quantum error correction code. Maybe it's the toric code, for example. Then we add some trap qubits. And what these trap qubits are qubits chosen to be in eigenstates of either poly X, Y, or Z operators. And we call them trap qubits because basically our computation isn't going to change them. They're going to be kept in a known state the whole time. And so we take this error correction code and the trap qubits, and we permute them. So the basic idea here is that we're going to choose three times as many trap qubits as three times as many trap qubits as qubits in the error correction code. Okay, The reason this is useful is that it's very hard to bound, to work out the exact probability of being able to cheat with this, but you can put an upper bound on it very easily. Imagine Bob has more information than he really does. Imagine he's told, in this set of four qubits, you have exactly one polyx operator. You have one data qubit from the error correction code, and you have three qubits that are trap qubits. Now, Bob has to operate on the data qubit in order to be able to change the computation, but he needs to avoid all of the trap qubits. So he has to operate on at least one site within this four qubit block. And to do that means he has a probability of 3 over 4 of guessing the wrong qubit and guessing the trap qubit instead. And then for the trap qubits, he has a 2/3 probability of being detected for whatever operator he applies to it. This means then that if we have an error correction code that has some distance s, then we have to operate on at least s such subsets. So our probability of a half of going undetected goes down, so it becomes 2 to the minus s. So it's a half independently for each one of these sets. And so this makes it exponentially unlikely that Bob can simply guess which are the data qubits, and so implement some logical operation on the underlying encoded space without being detected. So this is how we do a blind quantum computation. We do the computation all of this in this quantum error correction code. So in these authenticated codes with the trap qubits, and we go all the way on to measurements. But we have to do it in a fault tolerant manner. So our entire circuit is transcribed to a fault tolerant version. So we have transversal gates where possible, and we have magic state distillation or something similar along the way, which is why we need those regularly spaced measurement qubits. So since we have these regular measurements and we have all of the underlying gates necessary, we can do this. Now, this means that when we get to measure our output, we're just doing fault tolerant measurements. And when we do our fault tolerant measurement, we get some repeated encoding of the qubit being measured. So we get the classical output encoded in some kind of repetition code. So if it was 0, it should be something like maybe 0, 0, 0. And if it's 1, it's 1, 1, 1. But it's also interspersed. First of all, it's been one-time padded. Because we have, at every layer of the computation, we haven't corrected for the byproduct operators yet from the previous two layers. So there's an X and a Z operator applied that Alice doesn't know, that Alice knows the key to, but Bob knows nothing about. So what this means is, when she gets the measurement results, they're uniformly random from Bob's point of view, but Alice knows the key, so she can decrypt the one-time padding code. Now, because we've done the fault-tolerant measurements, but there's also a bunch of trap qubits that are measured, she gets back this classical error correction code that's interspersed with a bunch of trap bits, which is also an authentication code that works in exactly the same way as before. So she can be sure that her output's correct, that Bob hasn't just lied about the measurement results, for example. So this is quite useful. Because it allows us to securely do any quantum computation. So I want to tell you a bit about interactive proofs first, so that I can then tell you about the role this plays. So the idea of interactive proof is just trying to answer the question of what a computationally unbounded entity can prove to someone will say, however, that they're limited by the linearity of quantum mechanics when we get to talking about quantum curves. Okay, so the first class is called IP. This is just a class of linearity proofs, where you have a prover, a simple prover, and a classical verifier. So the classical verifier just can do some randomized polynomial time computation. And we want to know, so IP is simply the class of decision problems for which the answer is, if the answer is yes, then there's a strategy for the verifier to accept with probability at least 2/3, and if it's no, they must reject with probability 2/3. So this is very simple, it's just there's some way, there's going to be some messages passed between the prover and the verifier, and according to these, the verifier wants to determine whether or not a certain statement is true. And the idea here is just that we don't necessarily need them to know with absolute certainty, but as long as they have some bounded, some kind of bounded error, that's okay. So if there's any gap here, it doesn't have to be 1/3. But for example, if it's a quarter, if it's 3/4 and 1/4, or if it's 0.51 and 0.51, it doesn't matter because we can always amplify these. Okay. So there's a bunch of other classes related to this. So we have interactive proofs, first of all, in IP that are, you have a classical verifier and a single prover. But these can be generalized, so you might have more than one prover. Again, MIP then is a classical verifier with more than one prover, where the provers share only classical correlations. So they can come up with some strategy beforehand to cheat, that's okay, but they can't have entanglement. And they certainly can't be able to communicate during the proof. You have something called MIP star then, which is a similar thing, where we have a classical verifier and more than one prover. But the correlations between the provers are allowed to be quantum, so they can share entanglement, and potentially an unbounded dimension of entanglement. And then we have the quantum case, where we have quantum verifiers. So QIP is just IP, except the verifier is quantum. So they can do BQP computation, or they can process quantum states, as long as the processing only takes polynomial time. And QMIP is the multi-prover analog of this, where we have more than one prover, and they can potentially share quantum correlations. So they can share entanglement. And again, it can be some unbounded amount of entanglement. The only thing we require is that the provers be limited by the linearity of quantum mechanics, and that they don't communicate during the proof. So if you weren't limited by the linearity of quantum mechanics, if you could perform deterministic nonlinear operations, then you would be able to signal with your entanglement. So that's not allowed. Okay. So what's known about this? Well, fairly recently, it was proved that, IP equals P space has been known for a long time, but very recently it's been proved that QIP, where we have a quantum prover instead of a classical, a quantum verifier instead of a classical verifier, is also equal to P space, which is quite surprising that having a verifier that can do quantum computation doesn't help you verify any more sophisticated proof. So you can't. You can't have any more proof to you than you could in the classical case. MIP, it turns out, is equal to next. So this is just non-deterministic exponential time computation. It turns out that if we have a quantum verifier and no entanglement, which I haven't listed as one of the classes before, this is equal to next as well. So in the case where there's no entanglement between the provers, having a quantum verifier is QMIP with polynomial entanglement is contained within X. And it might seem odd to you why sharing entanglement between the provers could somehow reduce their power. But if you think about I don't know if you know this Merman-Perez magic squares game, where you have a grid that's, say, 3 squares by 3 squares. And Alice is given an index to a row, and Bob is given an index to a column. So you have something like this. And basically, Alice has to assign a value of plus or minus. So Alice and Bob are each given, so Alice is given a row index and Bob gets a column index. And what they need to do is to agree on an assignment of values to certain squares. So Alice has to fill in her column, or sorry, her row that she's got the index for, and Bob needs to fill in the values in his column in such a way that they agree on the cell that they both get. The value should be the same for both. And that the columns should have odd parity and the rows have even parity. So the values allow just plus or minus one, and you need to make all of the columns odd and the rows even parity. Plus, also while we're agreeing on this square. And it turns out that this is impossible. You can come up with an assignment to 8 of the 9 squares that is entirely consistent. But the last square you can never fill in. There's just no consistent way to satisfy this. However, there is a quantum mechanical strategy where Alice and Bob share EPR pairs and they make measurements on them. So they're still not communicating, but they're using the correlations of their entanglement to help them get around this. And so the danger is that there's some strategy. So if we've separated two provers and we want to kind of cross-examine them on, for example, some probabilistically checkable proof that they've come up with, and we want to check whether bits in analysis match bits in bits in prover one to match bits in prover two, then potentially prover one and two could use the shared entanglement to come up with some cheating strategy that's better than can be done classically. Now they can't prove any more, but they can potentially cheat. And we don't know how bad this is. What is it? So we know IP equals IP, QMIP with no entanglement equals MIP, but no one knows anything about QMIP or MIP star. So we don't know whether these are contained within MIP, so if they're contained within next, or whether they are contained next, or they're equal to next, or maybe they're just different. They contain some problems that are in next and some that aren't.
How could entanglement ever let the provers prove more?
Pardon?
How could entanglement ever let the provers prove more?
That's an interesting question. Okay, so I don't know if you know anything about probabilistically checkable proofs, but the basic idea is that a prover writes down some proof where you want to examine a certain number of bits of it, and you want to make sure that they don't change in between. So depending on how many bits of it you can examine, for example, that determines how much you can prove. So, this depends on how much randomness you have, for example. So, you can potentially see a situation where two provers, where the shared entanglement between two provers is used to generate a random string longer than a verifier could communicate to them in polynomial time. So, potentially you could have some longer set, some larger amount of shared randomness, for example. But it's simply not known whether it helps you or hurts you.
So the verifier would sort of demand that the provers do some kind of entanglement.
Yeah, so they share, they're assumed to share an unbounded amount of entanglement initially. And the question is whether you can use that to cheat, which you potentially can with this kind of magic squares type thing, or whether you can use it to help, for whether the verifier can exploit this. I'm going to show you one way how entanglement does happen in a minute. So I'm going to prove that QMIP is equal to MIP star. Now, I can't tell you where they sit with respect to next. I don't know that at all. But what I can tell you is that entanglement shared between the provers is going to allow me to eliminate the need for a quantum verifier. So if QMIP is more powerful than MIP, then having entanglement actually makes MIP more powerful. Or makes having shared entanglement makes the proof system more powerful. Okay, so there's also a related question that Scott Aronson came up with as to whether BQP is, whether there exists an interactive proof for problems within BQP such that the prover only needs a BQP computer themselves. So if I have a quantum, it's all one good saying, I can prove any problem in p-space to you. But actually, I can't work out the result myself to any problem in p-space. So I'm potentially limited by my own computational power. So if you want to verify, for example, the result to a quantum computation, something like a quantum simulation, or where it's not in NP, we want to know whether or not there is some interactive proof system that can be used to make sure we have the correct result. Where we only need a quantum computer to prove it to us, as opposed to some much more powerful computer. So, on to quantum verifiers. The basic idea here is that we're going to use two provers to implement blind computation. So, beforehand, at the first stage of our blind computation protocol, Alice was sending some qubits to Bob. And then after that, she didn't have any more quantum communication with Bob. So we can see this first stage of the protocol as setting up a certain type of correlation, where Alice has a label for a state, and Bob has the state, but Bob doesn't know what state he's been given. So Alice has a label for this angle, for the Z rotation, that's applied to these individual qubits, but Bob has no idea what it is, although potentially he can try and measure the qubits. He's still limited by the delay variant. So what we're going to do here is we use a second prover to generate the same kind of correlations, but without requiring Alice to have any quantum communication at all. So the idea is that the two provers, one and two, share some number of EPR pairs. And Alice then instructs the first prover to measure his half of the belt pairs in some angles. I've called it theta totally here, but so she gives him some angles, theta, and he measures them. So he's making some equatorial plane measurement, which means the other half of the EPR is now in either plus or minus theta, which means it's either the plus state with this set rotation applied, or it's in the minus state with this set rotation applied. So prover one sends back his measurement results to Alice, and now Alice knows what state Bob's half of the EPR pairs are now in. So she now has a label, some new label, theta, that we get by just adding the measurement result times pi to the original angle she instructed the first prover to measure. So this is exactly the same set of correlations as we had before. And so then the idea is that Alice will run the blind computation protocol with the second prover. A question you might have is whether this first prover can cheat. by either of the provers. We just don't know who did it. So what, if one of the provers cheats, we don't know who cheated. We just know that someone did. Okay. So this means that BKP is contained within something called, is equal to something called MIP BKP star 2, which means we have two provers who have BKP computers. Star means they share entanglement, and MIP is because it's a multi-prover interactive proof. So this wasn't quite what Scott asked, but it got us $15 out of $25 for it. But the idea then is to use this in an interactive proof system. So we imagine having a QMIP proof system, and we want to remove our quantum verifier instead of a classical verifier. So in order to do this, if we have our quantum interactive proof system, we just add in two verifiers. Two additional provers who share entanglement. And these two provers are going to be used to perform the blind computation. So the basic idea is that the other provers will do their normal, will provide their normal role and act exactly as if it was an interactive proof. Exactly as if it was a quantum multi-prover interactive proof. So they'll be doing the same computations as before, but the additional two provers are being used to implement blind computation. So this is shifting the quantum power of the from the verifier to these two additional provers. So if we can do this, it proves a number of things. It says that QIP is contained within MIP star. QMIPK, so this means QMIP with K provers, is contained within MIP star K plus 2. So adding the two provers here, and that in general QMIP is equal to MIP star. Now the first one's known, as I mentioned before, because QIP equals IP. But the other two are unknown. And it turns out we can do this. So the basic idea is that we have some standard QMIP protocol, in which we have a number of things going on in each round. First, the verifier transmits some messages, MI, to each of the provers, PI. Each prover then performs some computation depending on the message they receive from the verifier. They then transmit the results back to the verifier, and then the verifier performs some polynomial time quantum computation on the messages they've received. And during the intermediate rounds from the first round on, except in the last round, they're simply determining the messages to send in the following round. And in the last round, they're deciding whether to accept or reject the proof. So we're going to have to change these slightly in order to get an MIP star protocol. What we do is we add these two additional provers, PA and PB. I'm going to start from step 2, actually, because it's going to be more intuitive if I start here and then tell you about what goes on in subsequent steps and come back to 1. But it makes no difference in the order. So we have two additional provers, PA and PB, and we replace each step with the original protocol. So step 2, the prover's PI performs some computation on MI. That's completely unchanged. So they're getting some message. Each prover receives a message, except for these two additional provers, PA and PB. Everyone else receives some message, which they perform some computation on. Now, they obtain some results of this computation, and they're going to have to send that result back. So this is where things change. So they're not sending their quantum messages to the verifier. They'll be sending them to these two additional provers, PA and PB. PB is going to be the one measuring the halves of the EPR pairs. So they have a very limited role in the blind computation. But PA is going to be the one making the brickwork state and interacting back and forth with Alice. And so the basic idea is that each of the each of the provers is going to teleport their results. They're going to use their entanglement that they share with PA to essentially teleport the qubits to PA. But rather than telling PA the teleportation bits, because they're not allowed to communicate, they have to tell Alice the result of their measurements. So the basic idea is that they're going to create an authentication code. Alice is going to give them the key to an authentication code. They then encode their output, the output of their computation, in an error correction, in this authentication code, with the key supplied by Alice, and then teleport this to prover A. Now, it turns out it's possible. We don't need to use two qubits for every qubit that we teleport. We have two measurement results from a teleportation of a single qubit, but actually the trapped qubits, we can simply measure half of the order. We don't have to teleport the state. We can simply choose to measure the X, Y, or Z plane, which means for those qubits we only need to transmit one bit to us. It just slightly reduces the communication required. But it turns out this is an interesting way to see that this protocol must work. Okay, so then the verifier performs some polynomial-sized quantum computation. The way this is done is simply to run the blind computation protocol. But now we have an input there that's authenticated. So it's come in from encoded in various authentication, encoded in authentication codes from each of the different provers, P1 to PN. And these are used as the first column of the brickwork state. So PA can't interfere at this stage. If they change anything in them, they'll be detected because of the authentication codes. So you can run the blind QC protocol, without any danger of there being any interference from PA or PB. This will be detected except with exponentially small probability. We can also use PA to act as the verifier's private quantum register, which means they just have some state. So they start, in the first round, they start with the qubits they get from, they just start with a brickwork state, and the initial state is written in the first pairs of the computation as before, but then between rounds, PA retains some number of qubits, which are then fed in as inputs to the next round. They're never decoded. So it doesn't matter that we're leaving information with PA. Because it's in an authentication code, there's no danger of them interfering. Okay, and then, so step one is simply that the verifier transmits a message to the back to the provers. And so what's happening here is, as I guess you can guess, we're going to teleport the output of our blind computation to each of the provers. So we're just teleporting their message to them, which is encoded in an authentication code. So when they receive the message, the verifier then gets them to measure all of the trapped qubits. So the verifier reveals the location of the trapped qubits, they measure the qubits, and if they give the verifier the correct result to all of these, then the verifier sends them the key and continues. So they have then decrypted their message and can process it as normal. And if not, if they give the wrong answer, then the verifier knows to reject the proof. And that essentially gives it to you. So we can now do we can take a QMIP proof and do it with resources that are only in MIP server, or resources that are sufficient for MIP server. So we have a classical verifier now instead of a quantum verifier. But it's still essentially doing the protocol for the quantum interactive proof. So we've just shifted the power of the verifier to these two additional provers. So this means that QMIPK is contained within MIP star K plus 2, and QMIP equals MIP star. It turns out that these two additional provers that we've added in, so